We've known for years in the South Bay that there has been a problem with sewage coming from Mexico. 250 million gallons of sewage on average on a rainy day comes into the San Diego coast area. And if that was a swimming pool, would you go swimming in it? As a father and a husband, I would take my family to the beaches a lot in the past. We're just not going there anymore. We don't trust the ocean. We don't trust the quality of the air on the beach. You feel almost like you can't relax there because in the back of your mind, you're wondering if you're gonna get an illness of some kind. So I can't just turn my back and act like it's not a problem. Unfortunately, in this time and age, there always has to be a rock bottom scenario where people have to hit a rock bottom. And I don't wanna see something happen that's a health crisis that affects a lot of people in San Diego or in our communities, because we've been told for a while about this. And if we're not taking care of the problem now, when are we going to take care of it? It all starts here, the Tijuana River. The population is close to 3 million. 66% of all their sewage is dumped into the river and then becomes a major toxic dumping zone. This is raw human sewage that has chemicals and toxins from factories and agriculture. Border Patrol agents have to wear protective gear in order to work in these horrendous conditions. The stench singes your senses. The smell is horrific. It makes you want to throw up. People are getting sick with respiratory illness, spinal meningitis, MRSA, parasite infections, typhoid fever, and even a border patrolman who ended up getting a flesh-eating bacteria. All of this leading out and being released to pollute our Pacific Ocean. That means everything from personal garbage to industrial waste, tires, heavy metals that go through Tijuana neighborhoods and industries. This is where there was once abundance of wildlife. Salmon used to swim here, and now most of the ecosystem has either been destroyed or is in grave danger. Tons and tons of trash. How could we be so irresponsible? You're looking at the final dumping point of the massive river of sewage that is destroying our number one natural resource, the Pacific Ocean, and its wildlife. This isn't your typical chocolate latte with whipped cream. This is a toxic nightmare. Coming down this river equates to about 30 million gallons per day. That's 210 million gallons per week. 900 million gallons per month. In a year, that's 10 billion gallons of raw sewage. Can you believe it? 10 billion gallons per year of raw sewage is going into the Pacific Ocean. Are you hearing these numbers? This is a state of emergency, if there ever was one. And it's been going on for decades. It's been going on since 1935. That's 88 years. This is the big dump. Coming to a beach near you. A typical sunny summer day in Imperial Beach, San Diego, and people are strolling on the pier. But I'm thinking to myself, knowing there is a massive sewage crisis, who's in charge? Why the ignorance? Who's looking out for their families, the children, the pets? What about all the tourists from around the world? And why are these people fishing? Are they going to eat the fish? Look at these people strolling on the shore. I can't believe I'm seeing this. Why are the kids playing in the sand? Why are they in the water? Why are kids surfing in sewage? The visitors are not aware of the sewage crisis. People have already gotten severely sick. What's it going to take?
Our problem. And it's
there's this local advocate named Leon. This guy is like super passionate and has all the answers.
Well, my name's Leon. I'm trying to show people how we can solve the cross-border pollution problem here in Imperial Beach. Because right now, we're getting between 30 and 40 million gallons a day of untreated sewage put off our coast. And people just don't realize that we've had 500 days of continuous beach closures. So we're educating the public on what we can do. Yeah, when we take people down to the border and we show them, it's like a light goes on. And you know, we offer tours, and if you wanna go look at it, we can go right now.
I'm in.
So I took him up on his offer, and my partner, Larry Delrose, and I head to the border. We finally make our way out to the collectors, and Leon was extremely knowledgeable about the infrastructure and how everything works.
You basically have two types of flow. You have a dry weather flow like we have now, which is primarily all sewage and toxins, and it comes in and it's taken to the treatment plant. On big rain events though, which are about, you know, 14 days out of the year, this place is rocking. The water's moving about 60 miles an hour, and as you can see, nothing is left behind. All the sand, sediment, and gravel are moving down, and they reach the ocean at 60 miles an hour. They get there in about 6 minutes. Now, however, they're ponding the sewage and not allowing this water to race to the ocean where it would be cleaned by the natural processes of the ocean.
Leon was very helpful, and he showed us the many facets of the sewer infrastructure. We learned that this is no small problem, and there is no simple solution. Being so close to it and witnessing it all truly disgusts me. It shows me how irresponsible governments have been. It was unbelievable, the sight and the smell. One of the worst experiences I think I've ever had. It reminded me of the LA tar pits, except there was no tar. It was just bubbling gases and belching toxic fumes. God help us. This is a lot of crap. We gotta get out of here. So I had an opportunity to meet with former mayor of Imperial Beach, Serge Nadina, and current city councilman of Coronado, John Duncan, to discuss some of the challenging issues going on with the Tijuana River Valley.
Things are brewing, but we have to keep pushing until it's actually, the projects are in place and the beaches are open all the time.
There is momentum now. It was like pushing this giant boulder up the hill. If people stop pushing it, it's not going to happen. So I do think we're at a point now where things are starting to move. We actually are moving forward. We just have to keep going. I mean, it has to be a sustained push to get it done.
One of the biggest things that we've lost is the cultural and social life of our communities. The July 4th rough water swim in Coronado, one of the oldest and most important open ocean swims in all of the United States. A surf contest that Wild Coast and I put on for 16 years, we can no longer have because the ocean's polluted. We brought the Ironman 70.3 Super Frog to Imperial Beach. They're not running it anymore because the ocean's polluted. But also all the ocean recreation programs for kids. Our junior lifeguard program in Imperial Beach got canceled this summer. Camp Surf, a YMCA Camp Surf, can't run its programs for thousands of kids from all over Southern California because of the pollution. But the beach is where our communities come together, and when that's disrupted, it means we lose so much.
So many people that use our beaches are from the disadvantaged communities in San Diego. And people talk about helping them, but they don't connect it to keeping our beaches open. This is a place where they can come to get into cool air. They can leave 100 degree temperatures in the inland during the summer. They can come here, let out that energy and be safe and enjoy the cool air. And we need that to happen. We need these beaches open. Our most respected warriors are our Navy SEALs. When they come here to train in BUDS to become a Navy SEAL, it's in these waters. It's in this polluted ocean. It's in our bay, which gets polluted, and we need to protect them. It needs to be talked about honestly. We just need to tell the truth, and we need to take care of these sailors that protect us and do the most difficult missions for our country.
We need more action by the United States government and California leaders as well, including our governor.
So part of the effect on my life, most recently in 2017, my wife, who's a former Marine, contracted spinal meningitis from this dirty sewage effluent here in Imperial Beach. We were walking along the beach, picking up sea glass. She unknowingly had a blister on the bottom of one foot, and the bacteria got in. A couple days later, she was having severe, very severe headaches in the back of her head and her neck. We went to Coronado Hospital. They sent her straight over for emergency diagnosis. They did a spinal tap, and she was in the hospital for the next 12 days, suffering the effects of spinal meningitis. Directly, as a direct effect from this water exposure, we had a CDC representative from Los Angeles come down and do an investigation, talk to her. It was the only vector that we could find and determine that could have transported a meningitis bacteria into her body. Obviously can't recommend anybody get in the water. I wouldn't even recommend you sit in the wet sand.
We made a quick phone call into the Imperial Beach Mayor's office. Mayor Paloma Geary was available. So she set aside some time for us for a quick interview.
As an elected official, I've been working on this issue since then. And I've sat in these conversations where I've had people say, well, you know, we're making progress, we're almost there, you know, we just need this, we just need that. You know, that's why I'm calling for a state of emergency, because we're done waiting, we're done. The patience is run out. My community is suffering, my community is in pain. We're getting kids getting sick, not just from entering the water, but breathing the pollution. The situation is at a crisis level. So when I went to DC in April and I was told about the deferred maintenance and these rehabilitation costs, all I heard in my mind is 2028, 2030, 2034, that's time that we don't have anymore. And just as easily as Santa Barbara had a state of emergency declared because of their oil spill, or some of the cities like Santa Cruz had one because of the coastal erosion caused by the last winter storm events, or the toxic spill in Ohio, or the bridge collapse in Philadelphia. That's why we're calling on a state of emergency, because this is no different. Just because it's been going on for years doesn't mean that the dire situation, the crisis situation, isn't on par, if not greater, than any of those emergencies.
If we should call the boat to take us out of the ocean.
Yeah, and look at the brown. It's coming up. It just keeps coming.
The next big rain's going to be something, huh?
Oh, my God, yeah. IB was really an eye-opener. I mean, imagine these people closed 600 straight days. It's a beautiful town down there. I really noticed.
Like
I mean,
IB.
It is, they got a playground there. They got shade for the people. They sell stuff at the beach. They got the unbelievable pier. Such a sad, sad thing to happen to that town.
You could get it that way.
Yeah. Well, once we get all this, these interviews done, and we get all this into our heads, I'm going to give you my conclusion. You're going to give us your conclusion. And hopefully, it'll be so new, fresh, and different than anything else that we can really make a difference.
I think you have too many politicians involved, and you can't even get a starting date or a completion date. And I think you need somebody with some business savvy to come in, and also knows how to work politically across the borders, because this is an international crisis. Yeah. We've gotten more than we anticipated out of what we found, but what's your take?
I don't know, I'm just as frustrated and confused. I mean, my mind's going crazy, but you know, I live right there. Right there, I'm 75 feet from the water every day. I get up and I open my window, and it just breaks my heart to see the brown, bit by bit, destroying the Pacific Ocean. The other thing is, that's really getting my heart now, is in the beginning, before we did this, I was mad at of the people of Tijuana. I was mad at them. I'm not mad at them anymore. They're victims. They're living in such filth, non-sanitary conditions. It's not right. Mexico is not only a bad neighbor to us, they've let their own people down in Tijuana. It's not right. They don't deserve this. I'm not mad at Tijuana people anymore. I want to help them. So we're frustrated, but we got a bunch of people coming here now. We got Dan Plant, who's been working on this thing for 40 years. He's coming now. We got a bunch of surfers coming now. We got people that have surf camps coming now. We got little kids coming now. Let's go see them. They're here now. Dan, they're here now. There they are. Let's go.
You have a little more freedom with this documentary that we're doing, Dan.
Yeah.
Can you speak to the consequences a little more angrier than you can on TV?
The consequences of poisoning our society? Yeah. Well, Larry, as we know, this is a community of underprivileged people, mostly minorities. They have no political clout. They don't have a lot of money. So therefore, they are being stepped on every step of the way. They don't have the money to fight back. So what is happening down there is, yes, third generation sewage babies. For three generations, people have been poisoned down here. There is a study from UC San Diego that says 35,000 people every single year are being poisoned to the point where they have to go to the hospital or they have to see a doctor because of exposure to this toxic water. The people down in the South Bay, and it goes for both sides of the border, both in Mexico and the South Bay of San Diego, they have been poisoned for 40 years, going on 50 years right now, and the government of Mexico doesn't seem to care one bit about not only their own people, but our people as well. So what Baja California doesn't realize, and they should realize very quickly, is that sewage equals dollar signs. You can actually make a lot of money off of sewage, monetize sewage. It's happening all over the world. There is right now an Israeli company called Otis. They are a leader in irrigation and recycling. They actually cut a deal with the Baja government years ago, signed a deal to recycle and reuse millions of gallons of sewage every single day and use it for irrigation in the wine country. Baja California has a severe drought. Baja California has a severe sewage problem. If you take that sewage, clean it, recycle it, and reuse it, you solve both problems. Sewage gone, drought gone. Sewage gone, drought gone.
How much espresso did you have today?
Zero.
Wow.
I know, I don't drink coffee. Can you imagine if I did?
You know, it's not just surfers who are affected by the dirty water. We have a lot of people coming here for the first time, never seen the ocean. They get out of the car in the parking lot. Kids run with their boogie boards down to the water. If there are signs posted, there aren't enough of them or they aren't obvious enough. And either parents read them and think, oh, well, it can't happen to us. But it's a reality that the children are out there not just playing in the dirty water, but they're playing on the wet sand. They're getting buckets of water and making sand castles, and all of this stuff that's dirty water. And lately, we understand that scientists have demonstrated the air above this dirty water is also dangerous.
People still aren't sure, you know, and even though the water's passable, all that pollution is still embedded within the sand. So on days with bigger swell comes in, it'll churn it up. And even though the water may be clean, the soil or the sand itself is not. So it just boils it up and it creates more pollution. And then they test it, because they test it right on shore, which is where everybody's going into the ocean, and it's polluted. My eyelid got infected and swollen. And that scared the hell out of me. I don't want to lose my sight. I personally know five other friends, personal friends of mine that have one guy, some infection on his face. Doctors don't know what it is. It finally went away. Another friend of mine said that they think he got spinal meningitis, but they're not sure, which leads me to the kids. If you get them sick when they're young, it's gonna hurt them developmentally as they get older. So it's not good for anyone.
I've only seen since the pandemic the highest pollution factors that have continued to keep most of us in awe of why we haven't done anything for keeping our waterways clean. And to me, having a sinus infection or having pterygiums on my eyes from staring into the ocean and then the bacteria levels increasing, ear problems. Look, I'm not complaining. I'm just saying that there has to be some sort of closure to this stream that continues to pollute our beautiful ocean.
As a physician, I try to look at the science of it, and concerning, there is not as much science as you would think. The testing right now consists of testing for three bacteria that we find in poop, three different strains of E. coli, some of which can cause serious illness or even fatalities. We don't test for chemicals, we don't test for viruses. We're not sure what's in there and how it can affect our pets. And our pets walk in the sand, they walk in the water, then they lick their feet. So they're probably getting a much higher level of exposure even than us humans. Larry, I am heartbroken to tell you that for the first time I am seriously considering selling my place and leaving. The pollution being one, number of things happening with climate change, and I feel like there is not enough attention fast enough to fix these issues.
People fly across the country to like come and visit this town, and I couldn't imagine like feeling comfortable and safe if my family came out here and we show up from, you know, say the East Coast, and we can't get in the water. We spent all this time and all this money and all this planning, and we can't get in the water. Why not just start staying in La Jolla, start staying in Encinitas, other towns like that, you know? So it's just insanely discouraging. It is. And it's a lot of talk and no action, really. It's not just necessarily beach businesses that are being affected. It's every small business and any business for that matter in Coronado. You know, it's, why come over to the bridge to Sewage Beach?
Like, lots of my family members don't like to be in the water, so I'm kind of like one of them who like just like goes out there and I surf. But like, since the sewage signs have been up, like I haven't really been able to like go in the water that much. Even though the signs are up, I don't really care whether I'm boogie boarding or I'm surfing. I'm just out there having fun, so I don't really care. I would get really angry that like they wouldn't let me go. I mean, it's just a little sewage, like who cares? I'll go in anyway.
Children are naive and parents are not fully informed. The truth is we have no one policing the ocean. The stakes are high. People's health are at risk.
It just isn't a life that anyone should be living. It's really sad, I think, because this main street that we were on with the water flowing down it was houses on both sides and dogs running around on both sides and cars driving up and down, and it was literally like a river of sewage water. And I think it's really inhumane, the water that's flowing down the streets of Tijuana, for the neighbors that live there, for the animals that live there, and then for to go into the ocean and come back to Imperial Beach and Coronado. I know so many people have gotten sick from just surfing there. Animals have gotten sick, children have gotten sick. Even first graders in IB know what's going on, and they're writing letters to the president to stop this, and so it's just horrible.
There are sections of Tijuana that they have no sewage lines. They have no sewer pipes. We found a situation where in the city of Tijuana, this is not some jungle, this is not some far-flung place, this is right across one of the richest cities in the world. We found a community where 29 homes shared a water line, like a green water hose that you would go water your plants with. They shared that water for their drinking, for their bathing, for everything. And it wasn't just like that was an anomaly. There are a lot of neighborhoods that are like that. We just had a story recently in the Coronado News about activists in Tijuana. Although I don't know if you should call them activists, they're basically young adults and they're furious, they're fed up. And they did a protest on the beach there trying to raise concern to their elected officials to say, this is unacceptable. We should not have to go out and be in this filth. We should have clean water, just like anybody else has clean water. Because what we have seen for nearly a century is that the governments of Mexico and the governments of the United States cannot fix this problem. I'm not saying that as an opinion. I'm stating that as a fact. We have found that through our reporting, it has not been fixed by presidents on either side, mayors on either side, Congress, members of Congress of either side. They have failed. That's why our series was called Promises, Promises. Promises have been broken for decades.
This has been an issue for many, many years, and we talk about it academically, but this is a real public health emergency. It has been one for a long time, and it is a significant environmental justice impact in the South Bay. San Ysidro is a disadvantaged community. Imperial Beach is also a disadvantaged community, and this impact extends all the way up the coast to Coronado. It's really time now for us to use the tools that we have, the technologies that are on the shelf, and a relationship with Mexico to get real results done. We're at a point now where we can end that permanently, where we won't have even intermittent flows of sewage, where what comes across the border in the river can be treated and then discharged offshore, and the Mexico sewage that we currently are dealing with can be treated regionally, efficiently, cost-effectively, and then discharged safely offshore. And have a partnership with Mexico on trash, because while we've talked about sewage, trash is also a monumental issue impacting our river valley, our estuary, and our beaches and ocean.
By the governor declaring it a state of emergency, it sends the message to the administration, to the Biden administration, that this is a priority for Californians. And so it allows for the release of additional funding. What's really unique about the state of the emergency that we are declaring is that we're looking at it from not only an environmental perspective, but also an economic perspective. And what's important to note about this is that, you know, when I declared a public health care crisis last year, right, a year and a half ago, we did that because we needed to gather data. You need data so that the data can be shared with the federal government and the state government, so that that data is what we use so that we can bring additional resources and we can look at different pockets of money to bring that money down to our communities. And so that is why it's so important that the governor also declares this a state of emergency, so then they could trigger the federal government doing the same. Having someone like myself, who's a binational person, who understand communities, I'm bilingual, I'm bicultural, I was born in Tijuana, I understand government, and so it allows me to really work very closely with the Mexican government, not only at the federal level, but the governor and the mayor of Tijuana. We have continuous conversations and relationship building so that we are able to address this issue, because we know in the end this is an issue that is multi-layered, and I am really done with the whole pointing fingers, and I'm all about solutions and trying to really figure out how once and for all we can make sure that our kids who want to go to the beaches, right, in Imperial Beach and Coronado, are able to get in those any time of the day whenever they want to, and the same thing on the Baja California side.
When the beach was brown, as far as the eye could see, within two blocks of the beach, you were choked by sewage and ammonia. Somebody has to stand up for the people and be a champion and not give up. And when it's time to give up, double up.
So beginning in 2017, when we had that absolutely horrendous sewage spill into the Pacific Ocean of 200 plus million gallons, the silver lining of that incident was that it was finally large enough to force Washington, D.C. to pay attention. It was large enough to force all of the local and regional stakeholders here to actually come together and with one voice say, enough, we have to do something about this.
If Americans are willing to accept this because big business and the corporate activity and all the profits being made across the border are more important than the environment along the border, don't point fingers at Mexico. Start looking at the fact that the system that's supposed to be protecting the equal rights of the people in this area is not a foreign government, it's our own government. Sadly with this is it's probably going to take a whole lot of people getting very sick and dying from exposure, from the environmental, you know, risk that we've just taken for granted for too long. Sadly, it's going to be a major crisis, and then everybody's going to say, why wasn't it taken care of earlier? We already know it's there. We know the threat's happening. We know this is an environmental ticking time bomb. Why not address it now together with the opportunities we have rather than waiting for this to blow up into our face?
We're finding out now it's affecting into the air. Like we're standing here right now, who knows what we're inhaling at this moment. But they've started testing that now and finding out the stuff that people are afraid to go in the water for, they're breathing in anyway. And so it's definitely a health issue. What happens in Las Vegas stays in Las Vegas? Well, in this case, what happens in Mexico isn't staying in Mexico. It's coming right here into our cities.
So stopthesewage.org, we managed to get protesters out there on the Saturday morning before Memorial Day weekend because the Coronado beaches were closed on Memorial Day weekend. We have the iconic Hotel Del. We have 2 million tourists a year who come here in the summertime, and our beaches will poison them. And it's just, it's unfair, it's unjust, it's unreal that it's gotten to this point, because we know administration after administration after administration after administration has kicked this toxic can down the road so far that now Coronado is an environmental justice community. We're a frontline community in environmental justice.
These beaches are now poisoned. We have a beach sewage crisis on America's finest beach. It's unacceptable. My beach at Silver Strand has been closed since February and is likely never to reopen until Punta Banderas is fixed in 5 years.
We live in a binational area, but we have to show that we can fix binational problems at the local, at the state, and at the federal level. We call on all of our elected officials, especially at the federal level, our congressional delegates, and especially Vice President Kamala Harris. She's from our state. We need her here. We need Michael Reagan, the head of the EPA, here to see the devastation of America's most beautiful beach, Coronado, California.
Some of our Navy SEALs who train in these waters, our grandchildren's health, our children's and family's health, the health of our first responders, the lifeguards who have to go in these waters and rescue people. Our health and our community is in crisis, and we demand action now.
When do we want it?
Now!
The people of San Diego South Bay are united as one. Together we're making a call for action because they are fed up. It's time for us all to work together.
Okay, Peña Mati, Pecham. Estamos en Nachuña, Marco Pai, Wisconsin. Bienvenidos a todos. Mi nombre es Tam Rodríguez. Yo soy Pai Kumiai de Reserva Santa Isabel. Well, as a Kumiai, when we look at this, our people are people of the islands, the Coronado Islands, the ocean, the valleys, the mountains, the desert, parts of the Colorado River, and parts of the Sea of Cortez. And in our creation story, it talks about the sacredness of the water and how we obtain food. We are part of this ecosystem. We don't separate ourselves from it. And part of our duties is to take care of it like it's our mother, like it's part of us. It's a relative. When we take care of the different areas, the areas take care of us too. And that is the problem we have now with pollution, with the things that are going on. Global warming, we're seeing the effect that is taking place. The temperature of the ocean is rising. It's affecting our kelp beds. The sewage that is coming into the ocean, it's affecting the ecosystem. It's affecting the fish. It's affecting us. People who are going into the ocean now are coming out sick. And this is not how it was intended, because we have been here for thousands upon thousands of years. Don't discount organic scholars and organic science. We are no strangers to climate change. We have village sites under the Pacific Ocean right now. It speaks to a time before any of this was here. We can learn from each other. We can learn from each other if we open ourselves up to that. Another thing too, this earth is our mother. How do we treat our mother? Do we treat our mother with respect, or we discount her? If we discount her, our mother will discount us.
And the situation is getting worse.
I agree.
If it gets worse over in Tijuana, it's going to get worse here in the Pacific Ocean.
I agree. So this is an unbelievable thing that we uncovered in our research, okay? It's called the Rio Declaration. It's from the United Nations. 175 countries, including Mexico, signed this in good faith at the Earth Summit in 1992. It's like a blueprint for global environmental issues. The stuff in here, it's like human beings have the right for harmony with nature. Development must consider present and future generations. Countries should all work together. It's all here. But the main thing is that it says that people have the right to get the right access to information on the environment. We're going to do it, Brett. I think we're going to do it. We're encouraging public awareness, just like this says. Hopefully it's going to lead to some results. But we got to keep going.
And we do. And that's why the podcast is important. So every, at least a couple times a month, we're going to go over what's going on and what's happening. And we're going to be real about it.
We're going to do it, buddy.
All right.
We really are.
Because together.